Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Good Faith by Jane Smiley, narrated by Richard Poe. This work is copyrighted 2003 by Jane Smiley. This recording is copyrighted 2003 by Recorded Books. Winning the Pulitzer for 1,000 Acres didn't change Jane Smiley's life. Fame, she says, only exists in other people's minds. Becoming a mother at 43, buying my first horse at 42, that changed my life. It opened me up, changed who I was. In addition to being a successful fiction writer, she also comments on subjects ranging from politics to compulsive shopping for the likes of The New Yorker, Harper's, and The Nation. And now, Good Faith.
Chapter 1. This would be 82. I was out of the Viceroy with Bobby Baldwin. Bobby Baldwin was my one employee, which made us not quite friends, but we went out to the Viceroy almost every night. My marriage was finished, and his hadn't started, so we spent a lot of time together that most everyone else we knew was spending with their families. I didn't mind. My business card had the Viceroy's number in the corner under "May also be reached at." Buyers called me there. It was a good sign if they wanted to see a house again in what you might call the middle of the night. That meant they couldn't wait till morning. And if they wanted to see it again in the middle of the night, well, I did my best to show it to them. That was the difference between Bobby and me. He always said, "Their motivation needs to be tested, that's what I think. Let them wait a little bit." Bobby wasn't my brother, but he might as well have been. Sally, his sister, had been my girlfriend in high school for about 1.5 years. She was the first person I ever knew who had a phone of her own. She used to call me up and tell me what to do. "Now, Joey," she would say, "tomorrow wear those tan pants you've got and the blue socks with the clocks on them and your white shirt and that green sweater I gave you. And I'm going to wear my blue circle skirt with a matching cashmere sweater and I'll meet you on the steps. We'll look great. Have you done your algebra problems? When you get to number 4, the variable is 7, and x equals 1/2 of y. If you remember that, then you won't have a problem with it. Did you wash your face yet? Don't forget to use that stuff I bought you. Rub it in clockwise, just a little tiny dab, about the size of the tip of your pencil eraser. Okay?" I had been short, and now I was tall. I had been skinny and quiet and religious, and now I was good-looking and muscular. It was Sally Baldwin who brought me along, told me what to wear and do and think and say. She was never wrong. She never lost her patience. She created me. And when she was done, we broke up in a formal sense, but she kept calling me. She was smart and went off to Smith College. And I was sure she would get everything organized there once and for all. I went to Penn State. In April of my freshman year, Sally was killed in a car accident outside of Boston. I had talked to her 2 days before. "Now, Joey," she had said, "it's okay to see a woman who's almost 30, but you don't say that you're dating her, you say that you're seeing her. Seeing is much more sophisticated than dating, and it doesn't lead to marriage." I went home for the funeral. It was as if the Baldwins had been eviscerated. All they had left were Felicity, Norton, Leslie, and Bobby. That didn't seem like much without Sally to move them along. Betty, their mom, couldn't act of her own free will. The funeral director, Pat Mahoney, had to seat her here and stand her there and remove her from this spot and place her in that spot. Gordon seemed better. Almost vigilant in a way, though my mother said he would never recover, and maybe he never did. Bobby was 10 then, 9 years younger than I was. Gordon came up to me afterward and asked me how I was doing. He was concerned, the way you always get at funerals, and I couldn't help telling him that I wasn't doing at all well. I hated college and was terribly homesick anyway. And now there was this stunning thing that was the end of Sally. And the next thing I knew, he was offering me a job, and I was taking it. And I went back to pick up my stuff at Penn State 2 days after the funeral, and I started working for Gordon the following Monday, which I certainly would not have been invited to do if Sally were alive and my girlfriend or fiancé, because Gordon didn't like to be bankrolling everyone in the whole family, especially not sons-in-law. My dad used to wonder what the Baldwins' real name was. They weren't like any Baldwins he had ever known. Gordon was loud and affectionate. "Hey, honey," he always said, no matter who he was talking to. He ate out every night. He had 3 or 4 restaurants he took everyone to, owned by his poker buddies, I think. He played poker 2x a week, high stakes. These games had been going for generations. For a living, he bought and sold things. For a while, it was antiques. For a while, jewelry. For a while, cars. For a while, expensive fixtures out of houses and restaurants and hotels that were being torn down. Once in a while, he'd hear about some hotel in the city that was going under, and he would come home with a truckload of dishes or silver that carried a hotel monogram. One year, his barn was full of pink silk chairs and settees from the lobby of a hotel in Montreal. Another year, he got 1,000 commodes. That was the year he persuaded everyone who bought a house from us that you gotta have one more bathroom than the number of bedrooms. It's the wave of the future. Always land and houses and dairy cattle breeding stock. One thing leads to another. That is, houses lead to commodes, and then commodes lead to houses, which lead to land, which leads to dairy cattle, which leads to cheese, which leads to pizza pies, which lead to manicotti and veal parmesan, which lead to wine, which leads to love, which leads to babies, houses, and commodes. That was Gordon Baldwin in a nutshell. My father, who didn't like anything to lead to anything else because of sin, couldn't decide whether the Baldwins had originally been Obolinskis or Balducci's or Baldaggi's. He took solace in the fact that we were Stratfords, always had been Stratfords. There was no misspelling of the Stratford name since the Middle Ages. The Baldwins had come to town after the war. That was all anyone knew. And for all that Gordon had gotten rich and locally famous, and he, Bobby, and everyone else in the family talked and talked, where the Baldwins had come from was something they never talked about. Anyway, I could hardly keep my eyes open, though it was only midnight, early for a Baldwin, and Bobby was wide awake. He was drinking and playing craps for pennies with a builder we knew. The bar was about half full. It was a Wednesday. I said, "See you at 10. Bobby said, "See that? 5 and a 3. That's 8. "Bobby," I said, 10. "I have to show a house at 10:15, and I want to be sure you're there before I go." 10, said Bobby. 10 in the morning. In the morning. Morning is when the sun is in the sky and you don't have to turn on your headlights. Gotcha. Roll 'em. He looked at me and smiled. He looked just like Betty. I shook my head. As I passed next to the table right behind where we were sitting, I saw a guy look up, look at me. I went out into the parking lot. The parking lot of the Viceroy backed up on the river, the Nut. My condo was in a development in a smaller town upriver, Nut Hollow. Instead of getting right into my car, I walked down to the river and had a look at the moon, which was shining round and bright. The river was black and glassy around the circle of the moon for just a single long moment. Then the wind came up and ruffled the image. I saw there was a woman squatting at the base of a tree about 10 yards from the river. When she turned at my footsteps, I realized it was Fern Minette, Bobby's fiancée. She stood up with a big smile, wiping her hands on her jeans. Fern was about 27 or so. She and Bobby had been engaged for 4.5 years. I said, "Well, it's Fern. What are you doing, Fernie?
Cat entrapment.
You're trapping cats?
Well, my cat. He got out of the car when I took him to the grocery store Friday.
She pointed to a cat carrier with its door open, just barely visible, in a cleft up the bank from the river.
I put things in there. Liver, his toys. Last night he went in, but when I moved away from the tree, he ran out again.
She sighed. I said, Bobby's in the Viceroy. Maybe he'd help you. He's not doing anything productive.
You can't help with a cat. A cat can't be herded. A cat has to be attracted. I just can't figure out the thing that would do it. And as the nights go by, it gets harder. You should go away anyway.
Do you stay out here all night?
Till 2. Then I come back at 6. Go away. He might be watching me and making up his mind.
I got in my car and shut the door. When I turned on my headlights, Fern waved, then hunkered down beside the tree. The strangest thing about Bobby and Fern was that they actually discussed marriage. Neither one was the sort of person you could imagine having any life plan that would lead to regular hours, a house, and then children who accepted them as parents. Bobby was still on my mind when I got up to go to the office in the morning. Probably because I was annoyed in advance that he would be late and I would have to rush to my appointment. It was a sharp but clear spring morning, not quite to the daffodil stage. The sky was a cold blue-gray, but the grass had greened up on the hillsides, and it seemed like you could see each blade shining with chlorophyll. It was the sort of day when houses looked great, especially brick houses, and I had a brick house to show. One with a big front lawn and a newly black-topped driveway. The surprise was that Bobby was at the office, in a jacket and a tie, and he had the multiple listing book out of his desk, wide open to the listings in the high 100s. In those days, that was the back of the book, and there were some nice houses there. Houses up in Rollins Hills with 5 and 6 bedrooms and sub-zero refrigerators. I remember I showed a house up there with its own little sauna-slash-steam room. The buyers and I stood on our shoes in the bathroom, turning the 7 dials and staring into the little wood-paneled cubbyhole like we'd never seen running water before. Anyway, Bobby was deep in the Rollins Hills listings. As soon as I walked in, he said,
"Guess what? This guy in the bar last night, he's moving out from the city. I'm taking him out this morning, 11:30. He wants to see 7 houses today and 7 tomorrow, and then he's going to pick. You should have hung around, but I'm glad you didn't. It was this dark-haired guy in a gray jacket? Yeah. That's funny. He looked up at me when I was leaving. People always look at you when you're leaving the Viceroy. They're looking at you in disbelief.
They're looking at you in shame, Bob. Anyway, did you see Fern? She was out there trying to catch her cat.
She's never going to catch that cat. That cat has been trying to escape for 5 years. You know, when she moved into her apartment, that cat had the vermin cleaned out in a month. Here he is.
A Cadillac pulled into our little lot and eased between my Lincoln and Bobby's new BMW. Baldwin Development bought a fleet of cars every 2 years, always whatever some crony of Gordon's was just getting into. After the new year, Rollins Hills Motors had gotten the BMW franchise, and Stu Grade had sold Gordon 6 BMWs over a poker game. Bobby's was red. The local sheriff had been informed that Bobby's was the red one. The guy who got out of the caddy was very smooth-looking. Creased tan slacks, expensive-looking white shirt, Italian-cut jacket, tasseled loafers. He pocketed his keys and threw his sunglasses down on the seat of his car, then glanced around for our door. When he saw me looking at him through the plate glass, he broke into a smile. There was no one with him. House deals without women put you out into unknown territory sometimes. That was especially true in those days, when most buyers were families moving around the county to nicer houses or out to the country from the city. But Bobby needed something to do with his time, and I thought an iffy client was better than any one of his usual six activities: sleeping late, going to the Viceroy, going to the doctor, going to the dentist, doing repairs around his own place, or calling Gordon and asking for something to do. It was this last that had resulted in Bobby's employment at my office. Bobby was well-meaning and even smart, but he was a danger to himself and others, simply because he couldn't use any sort of tool or even do anything outside of his normal routine without hurting himself or getting sick. If it wasn't a broken toe from stumbling over a stack of weights at the gym, then it was poison ivy all over his face from taking fern on a hike, or some sort of food poisoning. Gordon said to me, "That kid could put his eye out with a hammer, or break his leg with a screwdriver. Real estate is the safest place for him." And it was. But I didn't think he would be any match for this Marcus Burns, to whom he was now introducing me. My clients were, or would soon be, waiting. My clients were careful buyers, the Sloans. I made a living in real estate by keeping track of what a buyer wanted and doing research, going to every open house, calling other agents, visiting model homes, just in general mastering as many features of as many listings as I could. But you couldn't get ahead of the Sloans. What they wanted to know about every house they looked at, even the ones they didn't like, defied preparation. They had been looking for 4 months, not an inordinately long time, but they had seen every house on the market in their price range, and now they just waited for new listings. Usually at some point you gave up on people like that, because you knew they would never buy. The one thing that made me think the Sloans would eventually go for something was their conviction that something valuable, or even precious, was out there. The more I assured them that we were on top of every available property, the more worried they got that we were missing one. I thought the tension would eventually become too much for them to bear. Needless to say, they were pre-qualified in every way. The mortgager was dying to lend them money. They were standing in front of their Toyota at the house, a Dutch colonial that had just come on the market. The neon-bright sloping lawn was framed by the driveway and scattered with darker shafts of daffodil leaves. A few blooms were out on the brow of the hill in front of the house. The weathered brick and black shutters contrasted with the brilliant weather, just as I had hoped. And I could see that Mrs. Sloan was opening up. But Mr. Sloan, who distributed office equipment in the tri-state area, said, "Needs tuck pointing." I hadn't missed that, but I hadn't spoken soon enough. Nevertheless, I filled in. "Not right away, 2 years from now." I followed them up the front walk. She was about 35, with red hair that curved around her head like a cap, and pale, easily flushed skin. She wasn't pretty, but oddly attractive. I tended to take her side when she disagreed with him, especially since he wasn't very appealing, short and emphatic. He opened the front door with a slight bump and entered as if daring the place to sell itself to him. It was a center hall floor plan, living room to the left, dining room to the right, kitchen behind that, family room behind the living room, nice enclosed porch across the back, and 4 bedrooms and 2 baths upstairs. There was another half-bath off the kitchen. Wallpaper everywhere. Parquet floor in the entry hall. The house was what people liked in our area. More compact than expansive, with a heavy, well-built feel about it. It is arrogant to assume that you know what will fulfill another's needs. Every expert on how to live, from Jesus Christ to the Monday afternoon businessman's lunch group of the Nutt County Board of Realtors, agreed on that. Even so, I knew that this Dutch colonial, just like 3/4 of the houses I had shown the Sloans, would fulfill their needs. Houses are houses. If you had a lottery to assign houses of appropriate sizes to random families, it would do no worse and no better than those families did themselves in finding abodes, because the accumulated human wisdom about dwellings is sufficient to satisfy dwelling-related human needs. But no. Mrs. Sloane sighed in the kitchen, her spirit that was uplifted in the garden now depressed. Mr. Sloane found his suspicions confirmed. In addition to tuck pointing, there would be replacement of the carpets and a new refrigerator. Making a low offer wouldn't solve these problems. It would only convince the Sloanes that they were settling for less than they wanted. As we went to our cars, cordial in every way, I wondered if I would return their next call. I was single. There were other clients. As I was getting into my car, Mrs. Sloane said suddenly, "We should put our house on the market. I think we're doing this backwards." "Honey," said Mr. Sloane. They had talked about this. She was enlisting me in a family disagreement. I said, "There's no one way to do it. You want things to mesh, but..."
"I just feel that if we had the money in hand for our house, things wouldn't be so complicated."
"I never think it's a good idea to burn your bridges behind you," asserted Mr. Sloane.
"I need something to happen," said Mrs. Sloane.
I said, "We can put your house on the market anytime you like." As I drove down the driveway, I looked in my rearview mirror. They were sitting in their car, arguing. It was a pleasure to drive away. I had been divorced for a year by then. My wife left me, I always said, as a result of terrorist activity. What happened was we were in Barcelona in 1969. We'd been married 2 or 3 years by that time, and every year we went to Europe. She loved to shop, so we were strolling down the Ramblas, I think it's called. We turned into a side street and went into one shop, heard some popping noises, came out, looked around, didn't see anything. We went into another shop, and she got kind of into the back of it. I went out into the street, then into a shop around the corner. From there, I could hear louder noises. And when I came out a few minutes later, I saw smoke and heard sirens. I went out into the middle of the Ramblas to try to see what was happening, and suddenly policemen and police cars were everywhere, and they were herding us all away from the shopping district. I could see the end of the street where Sherry had gone into the tile shop, but I couldn't get to her, and she wasn't visible. I said a few things in Spanish, but it was no use. They pushed us back and cordoned off the street. And then, literally, there were bullets in the air. I didn't know what to do and didn't have the fluency to ask. I went back to our hotel and got the concierge to call the police and a hospital or two, but of course there was nothing to learn. Everything was still happening. I went to our room, but that made me nervous, so I hung around the hotel lobby for a while, and then I made the mistake that was fatal to our marriage. I went into the bar and ordered a drink. Sherry appeared in the doorway at exactly the moment I was raising the glass to my lips. I admit there was something about it that looked excessively casual, especially since my clothes weren't disarranged or anything. Our marriage went on for 9 years after that, but to the last day she would append to every argument, "And for another thing, when there was all that shooting in Barcelona and people were being killed, you were in the hotel bar ordering a stinger. Why weren't you out looking for me? That's something I'll never understand." That was always the last word. Sherry was still around. She had taken the money she got from our marriage settlement and opened a restaurant across the Nut in Melton Township called L'Auberge Normande. It was not the sort of restaurant Gordon took everyone out to late at night, so I never saw her or heard about her. But around Christmas, she had gotten a 3.5-star review in the Nut County Reporter, complimenting her especially on her creme brulee and her pork medallions in Calvados. Sherry had spent the years of our marriage complaining about local cuisine, devising ideas of her own, trying to persuade me to find her a location and make an investment in her cooking skill and business acumen. I resisted. Anyway, now she was gone, and we had nothing to do with each other. We'd had no kids, no dog. It seemed to me as I drove away from the arguing Sloanes that there hadn't even been a marriage. Only perhaps this woman I knew who didn't quite fit in with the Baldwins, my real family. On the way back to the office, I passed Bobby and Marcus Burns in the red BMW. They were turning right out of Maple Glen Road, which I thought was interesting. Maple Glen Road had a couple of lots being developed by one of my builders, Gottfried Newell. Gottfried Newell built in the mid-200s, and all his houses, two at that time, had been my listings. Marcus Burns saw me and looked at me, even in that brief moment when I passed. Bobby didn't. When I ran into Bobby at the Viceroy that night, he was both secretive and self-satisfied. I plied him with beer, always an easy thing to do, and he revealed that Marcus Burns had very much tried to conceal his interest in Gottfried's most imposing production, a four-bedroom Queen Anne that had been on the market for 7 months. This house was Gottfried's pride and joy. At first he'd considered moving into it himself, though that contravened his dearest commercial principle, which was that workers can't afford to purchase the products of their labor. The lot was a beautiful acre that swept down from the house to a small stream over which Gottfried had built a bridge. It had a wraparound veranda. Gottfried had sited and designed the house to preserve three of the old maples that Maple Glen was named for. But the greatest pleasure of the house was a subtler one. About a year before, Gottfried had found a guy who did wood moldings, the sort of decorative relief designs they used to do in plaster. He was a young kid, not more than 30, and his last job had been repairing and replacing decorative woodwork at a state capitol somewhere out beyond Chicago. How he got to our neck of the woods and how Gottfried got hold of him, I'll never know. But he put him to work in this house for 4 months. The kid lived there. He got up every morning and made and installed crown moldings in every room. He was a scholar, too. He didn't just do what Gottfried liked. He decided what period the house referred to and then carved moldings from that period. He was a quiet guy, like a lot of carpenters and joiners, and that just made it all the easier for him to ignore Gottfried. The result was elaborate, elegant, and expensive. And Gottfried had been complaining for months that our local clientele didn't have the class to appreciate the house. Nevertheless, the kid was now at work on another of Gottfried's houses, because Gottfried just couldn't let him go. "You know," said Bobby, "I set it up perfectly. It was the fifth house of the day, and we went from there over to the place on King's Creek, where that woman has junk all over the place. And she sits there while you're going through the house and watches to make sure you don't steal anything from her collection. He wants to see Godfrey's place again tomorrow with his wife." "A wife is a good sign." "He didn't even blink at the price."
"Did you tell him how long it's been on the market?"
"He didn't ask."
"He will. After all, asking how long something's been on the market is the buyer's first obligation." I should say about Gordon, whom I had known almost all my life and worked for forever, that his idea of a good deal was unvarnished and old world. He wanted to make sure he took unfair advantage of everyone he negotiated with. In bridge, he trumped you. In poker, he bluffed you. In Scrabble, he used every tile. He haggled at all times and in every situation. When he took everyone out to dinner, he haggled with the waiter about the bill, not just about the tip. In fact, if the waiter took 10% off the bill, Gordon would sometimes add something to the tip, but not always. When he saw a sum of money that he owed, he discounted it by 20% automatically and paid that. If the clerk pointed out to him that he owed more than the sum he had laid on the counter, the haggling began. Beyond that, he didn't mind giving away far more than he ever saved by bargaining. He was not a miser by any means. He just viewed every price as a starting point. And his greatest regrets had to do with having been suckered, as he thought, from time to time over the years. In years of doing business for and with Gordon, I had been had more times than I could count, and then received the difference, or more than the difference, at some later date in another form. You could say what Sherry had said, that Gordon Baldwin lived to swindle others. But most people around the area, like me, didn't take offense. Just hit him up later for a loan or a donation. In a more timid and less successful form, Bobby adhered to the same principle. It didn't matter to him how much money he made on a deal, just as long as he made 1% or 1/10 of 1% more than the other guy. I knew Gottfried would sell for 10% or more off the asking price, not without ranting and complaining. Gottfried liked an energetic face-to-face negotiation of exactly the sort that Bobby, who had always been had by his father over and over, detested. Not too long before, Gottfried had gotten a buyer in a corner at a closing and threatened to grab him by the jacket and push him out a ground floor window. As long as Marcus Burns didn't force it, I knew Bobby would do the easiest thing and make a full price offer. But I was curious to see whether Marcus Burns was going to force it. So, I said, what's this guy do?
I guess he was an IRS agent. Can you believe that?
Anyway, now he's an investment counselor at that new office in Cashel Heights, that Merrill Lynch office. He knows the tax code cold. How'd you find that out?
Well, Bobby shrugged. I guess he told me.
And that was all we had to say about Marcus Burns for several weeks. Chapter 2. I would probably still have been married if Sherry hadn't acted to unmarry me. All through our last year together, she would say, "Are you happy, Joe? What do you want?" And I would say, "Well, yes," and, "I don't know, this is fine." And it was. My mental life was pretty clear. I would say, "Are you happy?" And she would say, "No." But then she had never been happy, in the sense of being satisfied or generally pleased. Not being happy was one of her good points. Not being happy led her to try things, like gourmet cooking. When I met her, she didn't know how to bake a potato. Every year of our marriage, the food was different and better. Roast chickens with onions and lemons stuffed inside and herbs crushed all over the skin were followed by roast chickens with herbs and onions and lemon peel ground up and pushed between the skin and the meat. Mashed potatoes were followed by roasted potatoes with olive oil and rosemary. And then she discovered how to boil the potatoes a little and then roast them so that they were crunchy and buttery on the outside and melting and soft in the middle. I always called our house Hog Heaven. I was the hog. She liked sex, too, and keeping our house neat, not to mention having it look just right. One year I painted the living room 5 times, and only Sherry and I could tell the difference, but we could tell, and we thought it was worth it. Another time she bought an antique chandelier for the dining room, and I spent days and days gold-leafing it. It was frustrating and painstaking work. The gold leaf was like sheets of ash, that delicate. But when I was done, the chandelier looked graceful and expensive, as if she had paid $1,000 for it, rather than 42. When my mother said afterward, "You know, your father and I don't care for divorce, Joey, but between you and me, I never thought she treated you like you deserved." I was surprised. She had just been Sherry, that's all. Someone who rubbed some people the wrong way. But my analysis hadn't worked in the end, since we were no longer married. And of course, Sherry had angrily predicted I was going to miss her. Why angrily, I don't know, because I predicted it too. It wasn't something we disagreed on. But the way I missed her, no one had predicted. I didn't miss the food, or even the sex. And I didn't miss the house, which she got and all the things in it, that I had built or fixed or done up. I missed the attention I had paid her, the time and effort that took, and the pleasant and happy feeling I used to have of being sure that everything with her was okay for the time being. The divorce lasted a long time and cost a lot of money, because I had made a lot of money all through the 70s. Every time the lawyers settled on some numbers, Sherry would agree to and then come back a few days later with revised figures. She had a lot of confidence in me, I have to say. She thought my relationship with Gordon Baldwin was going to turn into a windfall that the simple act of divorce would exclude her from. I spent several years trying to demonstrate how small time I was and would always be, while my estranged wife spent the same period of time trying to prove what fabulous business acumen and wonderful connections I had. Connections she alleged she had cultivated for me, that I couldn't have made the most of on my own. But maybe my business acumen wasn't so bad after all, because I'd done pretty well in the years since the divorce. Even with the uncertainty about interest rates, I'd sold a lot of properties, and I had also bought 2 acreages for development, a 40-acre farm near one of Gordon's farms, and a 34-acre piece with a nice old house on it that I could easily imagine living in myself, subdividing the acreage into 5-acre parcels to pay for the renovation the place needed. But it was not with these things in mind that I went out to the Viceroy a couple of weeks later. It was with nothing in mind, as usual. When I got there, I looked around for Bobby. The Baldwin I saw, though, was Felicity, laughing with a group of people I didn't know over in the corner. Felicity was a year younger than Sally, which made her a year younger than I. She was married to Hank Ornquist, who worked for the State Parks Commission. They had 2 teenage sons, maybe 17 and 18. I saw them 2 or 3 times a year, here and there. Felicity always did what she now did when I caught her eye. She got up and came over and put her arms around me and gave me a sisterly kiss. Then she put her head on my shoulder in a friendly way and pinched my cheek. She looked more like Gordon than Betty. She had long, curly, dark hair and a cheery smile combined with a sharp-eyed gaze. I kissed her back and put my arm around her waist. But our friendliness wasn't backed up by a close acquaintance. More than Sally or the other 3, Felicity had always set herself a little apart from the family, marrying someone entirely unlike Gordon, for one thing. Hank Ornquist was about as untalkative as a guy could be. For another, Felicity kept her holidays mostly at her own house. They would show up Christmas morning after breakfast, or leave Thanksgiving dinner to go to Hank's parents before the pie was served, when Sherry and I, not even related, would have to be sent home after midnight. So when Felicity, with her head on my shoulder, whispered, "Oh, Joey," in my ear, I spun my head to look at her in amazement. She laughed. "Oh, Joey," she said aloud. "Oh, Joey, what?" "Oh, Joey, I saw you come in, and you were so wrapped up in business you didn't even look around and see that 4 women were watching you." Which 4? I must say I was doubtful of this, but on the other hand, she didn't have any reason that I could see to be flirting with me. "You're teasing me." "That blonde at the end of the bar." "That's Carla King. She's a realtor, trying to figure out whether I'm doing any business tonight, so she doesn't count." "Okay, let's see. Oh, there she is, that other blonde coming back from the bathroom." "Lori." I said, "That's Lori. We had an unfortunate experience about 1.5 months ago. I'm sure she was watching me to see if my manners have improved."
"What did you do?"
"Well, I was a little drunk."
"And?"
"I believe she made the case that I had been discovered by her dog-walking neighbor at 6 a.m. peeing on her, that is, Lori's, flower beds. And that might have been true, because I did leave Lori's house before daybreak that day. And it may be that I was trying to avoid awakening her prematurely by not using the bathroom. But I thought that dog was just an excuse for the guy to be out patrolling the neighborhood when he should have been home in bed. Anyway, Lori doesn't count either."
"Okay. That girl over there."
Someone I had never seen before. Pretty, but who looked about 18. "She's a kid. Doesn't count for at least a couple of years. And only then if she's interested in me because she mistakes me for someone close in age to herself and doesn't see me as a father figure."
"Do I count?"
"Were you watching me, Felicity?"
"Always do."
I looked around the bar.
"Hank's away on business."
I turned the bar stool so that we were face to face. I said, "Who are those people you're with?"
but I meant, what exactly is going on here? She said, the woman in the red sweater is someone I went to college with. She came down from the city for the weekend. Those are her friends who came with her. I think she meant that there was more going on than met the eye.
Are they staying with you?
They're at the Blackbird Inn, that new B&B out on Route 5. And then she licked her lips. I continued to be astounded. I put my hands on her shoulders and eased her off a step, then looked at her again. She looked steadily back at me, smiling slightly, her eyes alive and her cheeks flushed. I said,
always do?
Always do.
Is my jaw dropping?
Oh, Joey, you are such a dim bulb. I've been flirting with you for a long time. Don't you have any instincts?
Not according to Lori.
We looked across the room at Lori. Then I said,
Felicity, do you think my condo is burning down?
And Felicity said, I don't know. Let's go check. She laughed again and put her hands together in a gesture of excitement that I knew well. It was perfect, in a way. She was utterly familiar to me and yet completely mysterious. She said, you go out to the parking lot. I'll sit down with my friends for another 10 minutes and then come out. You keep an eye out for me. And then when I get into my car, it's the silver BMW, you drive out of the parking lot and I'll follow you. I knew exactly what she was getting at. I said, you know, Fern might be out there. Did you see her? I think she's still lying in wait for her cat. That's okay. You speak to her, then 10 minutes later, I'll speak to her. Fern doesn't put two and two together until you tell her to.
She went back to her friends. I watched her for a moment, and then finished my beer and left. 20 minutes later, I was heading down Hardy Well Road, and in my rearview mirror, I could see the headlights of the last person on Earth I had expected ever to make love to. And I knew we were going to make love. And I had no doubts, as if I had been simply waiting for it to happen. Those moments when we were parking our cars and getting out and fumbling with keys, and I was directing her to the door of my condo at 1 a.m, or maybe the time in my life when I felt the most purely young. There was none of that grinding sense of getting through the various stages of an acquisition project that I often felt when I was flirting. No strategy, no trying to figure anything out. I didn't even touch her or take her elbow. No first moves that would lead to a goal. Rather, the air was damp and fresh-smelling. The grass was growing a few feet away in the darkness. Trees rustled their new leaves all around us. The stars pressed down on us so we didn't have to look up to sense them. My condo intended to take us in. All I had to do was find the key. It was Felicity who touched me. She slipped her arms around my waist and pressed her head briefly against my chest in a manner I recognized intuitively as ecstasy and at once shared. I had never kissed Felicity, not on the lips. How amazing was that? What an oversight. Now I poured kisses into her, and her lips, which were perfectly warm and cushiony, found a place just inside the circle of my own and nested there. We kissed and kissed. I could feel the palm of her hand glowing against the back of my neck. Her fingers pushed up into my hair. My hands were somewhere, the small of her back, her cheek, and I could feel my cock pressing against her belly through our clothes, coats and all. But really, there was only kissing. The dark house we made by pressing the portals of our lips together, so spacious and fascinating a place that our whole selves could go right in there and live. Of course, the kissing melted into something else, but there was no desire as I had formerly known it. That is, no imagination of anything to come, just a sensation of joined movement. The condo was cold.
We kept our clothes on and pressed into each other. I was aware of her size. Not that she was big or small, but that she was new. New shape, new weight against me. New fragrance. It was exciting. I found my way through the layers of her clothes and my clothes to her skin, which goose-pimpled in the cool air. And so we slid under the comforters, and then I slipped inside her, still kissing, always kissing. I heard her crying out, and cried out myself. It was the cries that seemed to make me come, not the other way around. The room was dark. I turned on the light. Felicity said, "Joey Stratford, I recognize you." Then she embraced me around the chest and laid her head there so I couldn't see her face. She was laughing so merrily, I started to feel remote and dizzy from it all. Finally, I said, "Well, Felicity, you have just given me the surprise of my life. Didn't you think I was capable of such a thing?" "I still don't. My assumptions haven't quite caught up with reality here."
"Oh, Joey."
That's what you said to start all this, as I remember. You whispered, "Oh, Joey," in my ear. Wasn't I bold? I was so bold. Bold as brass, my mother would say.
What would your mother say?
I don't think we'll ever find out, Joey.
Okay.
I had never made love to Sally. We were too young. But I had kissed her over and over, especially gentle kisses on her face, planted like a delicate grid over her cheeks and forehead and lips. When I kissed her lips, she didn't kiss me back, but let me explore her quiet lips with my own. She said it made her feel as if she were something precious. After she died, I got out an old photograph of her and kissed it in the same way, to make myself feel that she had been loved, loved by me as best I could. Now it happened that Felicity kissed me in just that way, carefully, setting one small kiss right next to another. And when she came to my lips, I lay still while she worked over their contours and then down my neck. When she was done, she sighed and lay back quietly. Her hand stroked my arm up and down. She was bold indeed. She touched me without shyness or embarrassment, or what you might call a sense of proprietorship. I had never felt anything like it. She sighed again. I said, "Are you okay?"
"Right as rain."
We were silent and still. Her hand came up and pushed her thick, dark hair out of her face. She spoke softly and sleepily.
"What time is it?"
"After 2.
"Oh, not that late."
I laughed at this very Baldwin sort of reply.
"What do you have to eat around here?"
I turned the light on again. 10 minutes later, Felicity was wrapped in my bathrobe, frying up cheeseburgers in the kitchen. I was sitting by the breakfast bar in my jeans and a t-shirt, watching her. She did it just the way a woman with a husband and 2 teenage sons would, slapping the meat around almost unconsciously, peppering it but not salting it, toasting the bread I had scrounged up in lieu of buns, finding onions and tomatoes and lettuce. She said, "I could eat both of these after that."
"You know, I always thought it was so strange that people would go to sleep after sex. I always want to get up and at least eat a good meal. Going to the grocery store, now that's a very sexy thing to do after you've been getting it on. All the food looks so appetizing."
She flipped the burgers and hummed a little tune, took the second batch of toast out of the toaster. She said,
"So, now tell me why you asked if your condo was burning down." "That was such a funny line, Joey. You are so funny."
She pressed the burgers with a spatula.
"Just to come on. It popped into my mind." "Pure genius," she smiled.
She put the burgers on a couple of plates, arranging the vegetables in neat rings, looked in the pantry and found some potato chips, did it all efficiently and gracefully. I said teasingly, "Thanks for the burgers, Mom," and put my arm around her.
What I was really doing was getting inside that force field of honest pleasure again. Then Felicity got up, went over to the cupboard and rummaged around. She came back with Tabasco sauce, sprinkled it all over her burger, and set it down. Want some? I don't need any of my own. I can feel yours inside my nose. Those Tabasco sauce people own something called a salt dome. What's that? Oh, it's a geological formation where there's a big pool of oil deep in the ground, and there's a cap of salt over it. You can extract both, I guess. Tabasco sauce is just a sideline business with them. Their real fortune is in oil. Daddy always said that if any of us ever ran into a McElhaney, marry him or her quick. But we didn't. She finished her burger, not without looking at it appreciatively, then ate her chips, licked her fingers, and sat back. Now was the moment to ask her what we were doing, what it meant, what she thought about it, what was next. Instead, I ate my own hamburger. I was not entirely motivated by uneasiness or fatigue or even indecision. Right in there with those heavy, hesitant feelings was something lighter and more expansive. Along with my knowledge of all the things that could go wrong here, there was a caroling inner voice that kept repeating, "What could possibly go wrong?" I cleaned up the plates and we went back to bed. It was bright day when we woke up. While I was rolling over, just beginning to appreciate the sunshine, Felicity bounded out of bed, pushing her hair out of her face. She was smiling and stretching, saying, "Oh, Joey, that was nice. Thank you. I feel much better." And I was wondering in what way she had felt bad. And then she took a big, deep breath, sat on the bed, kissed me in a sisterly way on the cheek, and said, "I have a million things to do before Hank gets home." I was listening for any sign in her voice of fear or regret, but there was none. She got into her clothes. She was very boyish in her way, casual but confident about putting on this and stepping into that. She had slim hips, a small pot belly, and small breasts, long arms, and a long neck. Her body was sexy in the same way that the whole experience had been sexy, a fluid combination of maternal, girlish, and boyish, not like anything I'd known before. I said, "You know, Felicity, this sounds strange, but I think you're the only mother I've ever slept with." Some of them went on to be mothers, of course. "We'll have to talk about that sometime, Joey. That's a very bad sign with regard to your level of maturity." "Do you think so?" She kissed me again. "No. Goodbye. I'm leaving." On the way out the door, she said, "By the way, Daddy seems to have solved that tax problem he's been having." "Thank you, thank you." She blew me a kiss and was out the door. Chapter 3. On Monday, Bobby presented me with an offer from Marcus Burns for Gottfried Newell's most expensive house. It was a full-price offer, but there was one contingency: that Gottfried would fence the road frontage with something appealing, like split rails. It was a smart contingency. The property would look better for it. If Gottfried had done it in the first place, the house might have sold more quickly and for more money. But it was a contingency that would drive Gottfried crazy, implying, in his view, that the property was less than perfect. When I came over to Maple Glen to present the offer, I was careful. I clapped him on the back. I was extremely enthusiastic. I exclaimed that it was a full-price offer with an early closing, only one small contingency. Gottfried, who was feeding electrical wire into a hole while someone two rooms away pulled it, shouted, "Stop! Wait a minute. Now." He looked at me for the first time. "What contingency?" "Split rail fence along the road frontage." He stared at me for a long moment, then shouted, "Dale, get in here." Dale, the young kid who did all the moldings, entered from the kitchen. Gottfried said, "That Maple Glen roadhouse, split rail fencing along the road." Dale shook his head. "No," said Gottfried. Dale went out of the room. I said, "What do you mean, no?"
"No split rail fencing. It's an aesthetic abomination."
"Excuse me?"
"That's a Queen Anne. Now, in this part of the country, the vogue for Queen Anne houses was in the late Victorian period, say 1890s. You didn't do split rail in those days. Split rail was more rustic, a pioneer thing."
"They aren't insistent about the split rail. They just want a fence. If there's a style that would..."
"They thought split rail. That's what they saw there."
"I don't know that, Gottfried. I can't remember how the idea of split rail came up, actually. What sort of fence would you put up there?"
"I wouldn't put a fence up there. I didn't put a fence up there, so if I didn't, I wouldn't."
"It's a full-price offer. The house has been on the market since the 1st of September."
"I'm going to move in there myself."
"You don't want to do that, Gottfried. That way lies bankruptcy. That's what you always tell me."
"No fence."
"How about a hedge?"
He looked at me, leading me to believe that a hedge was unspeakable. I glanced around the room. Gottfried was putting in flooring, which was wide pine boards of random lengths, nice and knotty. One of the knots caught my eye. It looked exactly like the head of a bird with a long beak and a wary eye. He said,
"It pains me to say this, but have you noticed the way that slope on Maple Glen Road curves up from the road there? It's a beautiful thing. It always reminds me of a woman's ass. I laid sod there, you know that? Because I didn't want to wait to have that nice feeling that I got when I approached that house from the west. I'm a cheapskate, but I didn't want to wait for the grass to grow."
Gottfried's favorite wrong idea about himself was that he was a cheapskate. I said, "You know, I've sold 17 houses for you over the years. Every one, I've had to pry it out of your hands, even though you were bitching at me for months that the carrying costs were killing you."
"A guy who wants to put a fence around the swell of a woman's buttock doesn't deserve to live there."
"He loves the house. It's the only house he wants. He thinks it's perfect."
"Perfect for what? Entertaining? Showing off? I guarantee you this guy's an egomaniac. Mark my words."
"You haven't met the guy, Gottfried." He turned on me suddenly and shouted,
"You want to make this sale? You put up the fence. I don't ever want to see that house again, though. Out of your commission, a goddamn white board fence, clean and straightforward, no split rails. I won't pay for it, and I won't build it, and I won't even look at it. But I'll sell the house at full price to this bozo because the bank's got me by the balls. Do you know what my life is like? I worry every night about carrying costs. And then you take some guy out there, and bingo, you got 15 grand that comes right out of my pocket. What are you coming around to me for? Ask me about this shit. Dale."
"Then you'll take the offer?"
"You build the fence and I'll take the goddamn offer."
I went over to the work table and laid out the papers. They were already flagged for signatures, flagged in yellow, though they might as well have been flagged in red. I handed Gottfried a pen. He managed to sign the papers without tearing through them, but I knew he would rant around for the rest of the morning. Fortunately, Dale, the only guy working with him that day, was impervious. When I first met him, Gottfried was a shop teacher at the middle school, building houses on the weekends. When I listed his first house, he was amazed and gratified to have made it to the selling stage. He was utterly polite with me, almost obsequious. But that vanished when he met the buyers. They didn't meet his standards. No buyers ever had. But he had made a fortune. His houses were famous. Magazines took pictures of them. Commercials were filmed in them. I was his only listing agent. Sometimes we socialized, and once, over a beer, he had loosened up and told me that when his family was escaping the Huguenot purges in France, they had changed their name to Noel because Noel meant nothing or no one. He'd looked at me and said,
"Think about that, Joe. Think about running off to North Dakota or somewhere and changing your name to Joe Nobody."
For whatever reason, after he told me that, I didn't take his rants personally anymore. Nevertheless, I was more than relieved to flee with that signed purchase agreement in my hand.
I got back to the office planning to give Bobby the papers right away before Gottfried Newell could find me and recant. But Bobby was nowhere to be found. I put the agreement on his desk and hand-printed a note saying, "Get this to the buyer ASAP before the seller changes his mind." When the phone rang, I was tempted not to pick it up, but I did anyway. If you're a realtor, you have to answer the phone. That's the first rule of business. It was Gordon Baldwin, not Gottfried. That put me in a better mood right there. Gordon was my main builder over the years, and his market was much different from Gottfried Newell's. Gordon bought farms. He had been buying farms for 25 years. He had a farm-buying pickup truck, an old International Harvester with what sounded like a tractor engine under the hood. He also had farm-buying clothes, not quite overalls and a straw hat, but almost. He also had a farm-buying lingo. One of his many connections would tell him that some farmer was getting old and didn't have any farming children, or that some kids who lived in Portsmouth had inherited the family farm, and he would get on the proper costume and go talk to whoever was in a state of landowning flux. Often enough, he would come back home with an oral agreement to buy, and then I would follow up on the deal with paperwork. By the late 70s, Gordon had quite a few farms, amounting to several hundred acres in all. Some of them contiguous, some of them close to town, some of them way out in the middle of nowhere. Those were the farms where he kept his cattle. One piece of property, some 120 acres, was a development about 10 miles from West Portsmouth that Gordon had been building on at least since I got into his business. It was called Glamorgan Close. My father thought this name was ridiculous. The acreage was open, almost flat at the front, rolling more steeply toward the back. My father never tired of pointing out that, on the one hand, a close was a stabling area, and on the other hand, there was nothing close about Glamorgan Close, and nothing Glamorgan-y either, since there wasn't a Scot anywhere in the vicinity. Glamorgan Close had had several phases. Phase one, near the highway to Portsmouth, had inexpensive three-bedroom houses with small front yards, large backyards, and three styles, the Maryland, the Virginia, and the South Carolina, which had a larger front porch, labeled in the brochure as the Veranda. These houses, which were on straight streets, Kinlock Avenue, Glengarry Avenue, Kirkpatrick Avenue, were a quarter mile from the elementary school Gordon had talked the county into, and a mile from the Kroger's shopping center. Phase one was a big success. Behind phase one was phase two, Stewart Way, Robertson Way, and Ivanhoe Way. Phase two featured three-bedroom houses also, but with 2.5 baths and a bonus room. Phase two styles, the Sonoma, the Mendocino, and the Santa Rosa, had somewhat larger rooms than the phase one styles, lots of wood and beams, decks off the back, and a little bit of a view. The ideal couple who moved with their first two toddlers into the Virginia would find themselves 10 years later entertaining junior high schoolers in the bonus room of the Sonoma, the deck of which could easily support a hot tub. If the couple did extremely well and maintained the integrity of their assets by not divorcing, Gordon was ready for them with phase three, the Greenwich, the Hastings, and the Ardsley. Four bedrooms, four baths, master suites with sitting rooms, screened-in verandas, center island kitchens, and mother-in-law apartments. These properties, Blacklock Circle, Preed Circle, Tartan Circle, were larger and had better views than those in the other two phases, and, in fact, looked down on the other two. But at this point, the ideal couple was expected to finance the down payment of their eldest child and his or her spouse in one of the Phase One houses, which now had mature landscaping and the individuality born of age and idiosyncratic property ownership. This was Gordon's vision of life, even if he didn't say so. You made your way and populated your vicinity with your offspring, who then dropped the grandchildren off at your house whenever they felt like it. Phase three was essentially complete now, some 20 years after groundbreaking for phase one. There was still some land, though not much, and Gordon was going to start phase four when he could get around to it. Glamorgan Close was not Gordon's only development, but it was the one that had established him in the Portsmouth area. Selling houses in Glamorgan Close was as simple as putting a notice in the paper that one was available. They were reasonably priced, well enough built, and perfect examples of my basic belief about housing and the corollary, that what people really like is simple canvas to fiddle around with. Gottfried Newell couldn't stand anyone to fiddle with his houses, but Gordon relied upon his buyers to transform the uniformity of his developments. Gordon had some ideas about Phase 4, and he wanted to talk to me about them. Gordon's other developments were smaller and less philosophical, and he also built commercial properties. If one of his cronies wanted to open another restaurant or put in a miniature golf course with 6 waterfalls and a merry-go-round, Gordon would do that. He had sold one farm 10 years ago, way out in the country, but at a busy intersection of Highway 12 and Hardywell Road, to Bert Milstein, and then built a colonial-style shopping village that specialized in shops that sold one thing, door handles or table linens or fudge. The security guards wore knee pants, and the waitresses wore long skirts and frilly décolletage. And the center had succeeded against all odds, partly by hosting non-retail events like chamber music groups and pig roasts, and partly by hosting craft fairs and swap meets. It had become a very successful fake village, and Gordon loved it. It was not at all the sort of place he would ever shop or even go, but exactly the sort of place where he could sell high what he had bought low. He couldn't believe how the small shops and upscale decor put people in the mood to pay through the nose. But he had a little antique shop there, which Betty ran with a friend, and he stocked it with whatever he had found here and there. One year, they made a huge amount of money on gilt-framed mirrors that he got out of a hotel in Buffalo. Another year, they had 15 golden oak washstands and a rack full of silk kimonos from pre-war Japan. At any rate, I got in the car and drove over to Gordon's in a happy mood. Phase 4 would be simple and fun. Gordon would build them, and Bobby and I would sell them. One of the ways that Gordon kidded himself that he wasn't supporting Bobby was that he only discussed his projects with me, and Bobby did all his sales of Gordon's properties through me as the broker. Of Gordon, my mother always said, "Well, I never thought he was a handsome man, though obviously some people do." Some people did. He looked like a movie star of a certain era, Tyrone Power, say, whose looks not only change but become outmoded. In his early 60s, he was florid and jowly, and his dark, pomaded hair had failed suspiciously to thin or recede. He had big shoulders and big hands, but he was actually not a large man. I was an inch or two taller and outweighed him by maybe 15 or 20 pounds. What he had was ease of movement. When he opened the door for me, put his arm around me, propelled me across the foyer into his office, shouting the whole time for Betty to come out and say hi and bring me a beer. It was his dance. His touch and his presence felt like they were infusing grace into me. In his office, which was pure 1970, orange shag carpet, a long, low window looking out on their back acreage, which featured a man-made pond with a swimming raft and a rope swing hanging from the limb of a big oak, he had the plans for townhouses spread out on his desk. At first, say just for 2 or 3 minutes, I forgot that Felicity had put us in a new and strange relationship. He was just Gordon and I was just Joe, and we were about to do what we had done so many times, build and sell and drink and eat and talk and shout and curse or celebrate as the deals rolled by. Then Betty came in with a beer. Betty was about 60 then. I suppose when I first met her, she was in her mid-30s, and of course, she had changed. Sally had adored Betty. What she always said was, "My mother was a legendary beauty, you know. None of us girls will ever be as beautiful as my mother. Daddy says that's evidence right there that the theory of evolution is wrong." Then she would laugh, so pleased that she was lucky enough to be Betty's daughter. I liked beautiful women as much as anyone, and I had seen quite a few over the years who possessed a more perfect surface than Betty. But she had a thoughtful and yet entirely untormented quality that I had never seen in another person that made her beauty open, contented, and unsullied. Of Betty, my mother always said, "She's a very nice woman, Joey. Between you and me, he's lucky to have her."
That was my mother's highest compliment. She came right over and kissed me, put the beer in my hand, closed my fingers around it with her own fingers, and said, "Here's Joey. Aren't you looking handsome, Joey? I've been missing you." And even though Felicity did not look like Betty, in Betty's presence I felt it as a physical jolt that Betty and Gordon would not in the least appreciate the new turn my relationship with their family had taken. Gordon might understand it as a general feature of male behavior, though he wouldn't like it. But Betty, I thought, wouldn't understand it at all. Nevertheless, I returned her kiss, and maybe I did so with more enthusiasm than usual. I had always appreciated Sally. Now I appreciated Felicity, too. Betty said she was going to the supermarket, so Gordon came over and danced her to the door of his office. She looked back at me over his shoulder. Her smile and her wave were sophisticated but intimate, implying that while nothing much surprised her, she was happy anyway. Then he propelled me toward the plans.
"Now, here it is, Joe. Good American-style townhouses, nothing fancy. 3 buildings, 30 units in all. 18 2-bedrooms, 12 3-bedrooms. Look at this elevation now. Simple pitched roof, clapboard siding, white trim, cream siding, black doors and black shutters. They're going to go along the street like this, but a little set back. You know, when we went down to South Carolina at Christmas, I went over to this plantation they had outside of Charleston. It was called Forbes Plantation, one of those big old places. But it hadn't been burned down by Sherman, you know. Even so, one guy couldn't afford to keep it, not in this day and age, so they turned the whole thing into condos. Did a nice job, too. Didn't change the exterior at all. I think they got 8 units into the main building, and then maybe 4 or 5 into the outbuildings and the slave quarters. Anyway, here was the great part. He moved his finger across the bottom of the elevation. They made sure to keep the old gardens, front and back. And I'm telling you, these folks who live in this place, it's like living in a park. So that was what made me think it was time to get on with Phase 4 up there, because just a bunch of townhouses is nothing. I wasn't interested. But now I see we can retain control of the property and have beautiful gardens all around. That piece there faces southeast, so they'd have flowering trees and roses. Don't you love it? Little playgrounds for the grandkids, and some gardening areas for the old Italian guys who want to put in a few tomatoes. I'd live there myself if Betty could stand it. But she can design the garden. Or Hank could. He does that sort of thing. I said, self-consciously. So, here we go. What day is today? March what? Oh, yeah, 29th. Now, see, we got all the roads and sewers and everything here from the other 3 phases. They staked it out last week. So we just got to wait a couple of weeks to break ground. I said,
what sort of price range are you thinking, Gordon?
Something nice, you know, something friendly. $49.9 for the 2 bedrooms, $79.9 for the 3s. But they got an association fee, of course. Fee simple once you're inside the house, but got to pay an association fee as soon as you step down off your bottom step onto the walkway. And see, back here, a little park-like area. That's the latest thing, common areas. Pool, maybe. Or better, an indoor lap pool that you can swim in all year round for the exercise. We'll see. Milstein, he built himself one of those. And now he comes to every game with his hair wet. And he drinks water all the time. Jack, you want a beer? Nathan, you want a beer? Gordon, how about a beer? And then, Bert, you want a glass of water? I swear. But I see it coming, Joe.
The plans were simple. Slab foundations, parking spaces instead of garages, but rather large rooms. If there was one thing Gordon knew about real estate, it was that you could trim a little off the necessities and add a little to the space and make the place look open and desirable. I said, how about vinyl siding? That'd save you money all around and they can't paint it. You don't want these places all looking different 10 years down the road. He said, you know Frank Lloyd Wright, Joe?
Not personally. Well, he was a big deal. Still is, for that matter. But when I was just getting into this business, I used to read about him whenever I could. And he did a thing I always thought was funny. He designed the chairs for his houses. But he made sure they were uncomfortable, because he didn't like people sitting down. So he'd put in this furniture that looked nice and fit right in, but you couldn't stand to sit in it for more than 10 minutes. So you'd get up and walk around, which he wanted you to do so you would admire the place, I guess. Anyway, that's a perfect Frank Lloyd Wright idea. Sell him the house, but give him siding they can't paint. Ha!
Vinyl-clad windows, too. And you ought to put in crank-out casements rather than double hungs. For some reason, all my buyers lately want them, and they're cheaper to install. I was getting excited. 30 units was a good number. I could think of 3 possible buyers already. May I take the plans to show around? You know the Rebarkacks on Robertson Way? They were asking me to find them something smaller.
Pre-solds, that's what I need. You know, if the foundations of the first building are in by June, you can do a muddy shoe walkthrough of the samples in mid-July. I got my best crew free. They can get these places up in no time. You know Larry, who runs that crew, Larry Svensson? Back in the 60s, when he was just married, he made a bet with that old guy, Lombardo, that he could build a whole house in a month, from staking out to turning the key. He did it, too. 29 days and 5 hours. 3 bedrooms, 2 baths, split level. The electricians would be right behind the framers, and the sheetrockers right behind them. One guy was putting up the moldings, and the painter was painting them was right next to him. He finally had to yell at the guy to back off long enough to let him nail him down. Lombardo walked through and paid Larry $1,000 right on the spot. And Milstein made book. I bet $5,000 changed hands when the buyers moved in.
I think it looks great, Gordon. You lay out the gardens and put in annuals and turf, and that's not much money out of pocket, but it makes the place look great. Then over the fall and winter, you put in the trees and perennials, and by this time next year, it looks like people have been living there for years. Gordon grabbed me by the shoulders and planted a big kiss on my cheek. He said, "You know, Joe. How old am I?" "You're 63, Gordon.
Here's the deal. A lot is the world's most boring thing. I love to look at farms and buy farms and all that, but when I've got one and it's been surveyed into lots, my heart kind of sinks. But when we get to this point, where we got the plans and we know how fast the buildings are going to go up and the people are going to get in there, and I feel great. I feel 62. We laughed. I finished my beer. Gordon turned and looked out the window, then turned back to me. I had a feeling he wanted to say something unaccustomed, but to be frank, given the sudden appearance of felicity in my life, I didn't want to hear anything unaccustomed. And so when he turned back and offered me another beer, I shook my head. I bent down over the desk and began to roll up the plans. "Are these the ones I can take? I'll show them to Bobby if you want."
"Nah, he and Fernie are coming over tonight," Buddy says. "I'll show them. But wait a minute, Joe. I got this other deal, too. That's what I really wanted to talk to you about."
Deal was a safe word. I said, "What's that?"
"You know the Thorpe property?
Salt Key Farm?"
"That's the one."
Gordon raised his eyebrows.
"I got it."
I whistled. Salt Key Farm was hardly a farm. It was a 580-acre estate owned by the wealthiest family in the eastern half of the state. They had properties all over, but Salt Key Farm was something of a jewel. The Thorpes were railroad money, train coach makers and engine builders, but the decline of railroads had meant nothing to the Thorpe fortune. Over the years, the money had become self-generating. At any rate, Jacob the Fourth and Dolores Thorpe, who were probably in their 80s, lived much of the year at Salt Key Farm with servants and horses. The houses, a main house and 2 other houses, and the barns for mares, stallions, weanlings, hay, and so on, and the fencing were all simple and elegant, built on a grand scale. I said, "Did you see inside the house, Gordon?"
"Sat right in the paneled study."
"You haven't ever seen anything like this paneling, Joe. Split maple, book matched. The edges just melted together. No moldings to hide any flaws. Pegged floors. You know how before the French Revolution, the Queen of France had a little toy farm that was a sort of rich people's version of life in the country? Well, this study was a rich people's version of simplicity. He showed me the barns. All the horses' stalls were tongue and groove, golden oak, chevron style.
Why in the world would they sell, Gordon? They can't need the money.
I don't think they need the money. My guess is they had some big argument with the kids. Those Thorpes are like that. Always a big argument. John Thorpe, I guess he was Jacob's uncle. He made a will in 1910 that put all his money in trust for generations yet unborn. Everyone then alive, even the babies, had to be dead before they could distribute the money. There was a piece in the paper about it when the last one died a year or so ago. Anyway, the old man called me up the other day and asked me to come over. He said he wanted to sell me Salt Key Farm. And what I did with it was up to me. Except he wanted it advertised and put on the market for 6 months so the relatives could see it. If any of them wanted to buy it, I'm supposed to put some sort of deal-breaking contingency on it. But I guess that's your department.
Did you talk about developing it? I said.
Well, you must know I'm a developer. But let's pretend I don't know what I might do with it. It's not like anything else. He said he'd looked around and decided I was the only guy who could afford to buy it. I said, well, appearances are deceiving, but it is quite an opportunity.
I can't believe they want it developed.
Well, let's put it this way. He offered to sell me the property. I didn't say, Mr. Thorpe, I'm going to put 30 houses on this farm, and I don't know that I am. I could live there with all my kids and their families, and we'd never see one another if we didn't want to.
There was a time before my divorce when I used to drive around and fantasize about owning this property or that one, living with this view or owning that particular house. I was pretty rich, and I thought I was going to be richer, and the county was my own buffet. Wheeling and dealing would, I thought, get me any dish on the table if I wanted it enough. Any dish on the table but Salt Key Farm. Gordon went on.
What he said to me was he wanted to list it for $5 million, and then after the relatives had seen it and maybe tried to buy it, he would sell it to me for our agreed-upon price, which is high enough as it is. They want to move to Florida. I'm telling you, Jake, Thorpe didn't look good, and Dolores Thorpe looked worse. She came to size me up, too, in that tony, polite way that covers everything up.
How much?
$2.5 million.
Back in 82, nobody I knew, including Gordon, had ever even heard of pricing a house at $2.5 million. Now it was my turn to raise my eyebrows. This did not seem like Gordon's sort of money.
So, he continued, I guess you're the listing agent. You go out there and do the paperwork for the sale and put together the pictures, and we'll put it on the market like the guy said and see what happens.
I feel like I'm a little out of my depth, Gordon.
Well, son, that means it's time to swim.
He laughed, but I could see he was a little intimidated, too, probably by the seller's idiosyncratic motives as much as by the size of the deal.
Phase 4 of Glamorgan Close had a better feel to it. Simple, straightforward housing for local citizens so that they could enjoy, or at least get on with, their lives. Nothing eccentric that could somehow backfire. Gordon put his hands in his pants pockets and cocked his head.
Here's a question I ask myself. Why did he really call me? Why would he think I'm the only guy around who can afford it? My specialty is to buy it cheap. I've never spent any time with a guy. Our social circles not only don't intersect, they don't even recognize each other.
He shook his head.
Now, there's two sayings. Both of them are true. One is, don't look a gift horse in the mouth. That's what Betty says. The other is, if it seems too good to be true, then it is. That's what Felicity says. I mean, you can tell this shook me up a little because I never asked their advice, do I? So, what the hell? He's an old man, and maybe he's a little addled.
He handed me Jacob Thorpe's card. I looked at it and put it in my pocket. Why not? I thought. I said, when do they want to relinquish possession?
October 1st.
6 months?
Well, they got a lot of stuff to move out of there.
He looked at me and grinned.
And he wants to be around for the scandal with the relatives.
What if some unrelated buyer shows up and actually wants to pay $5 million for it?
I looked up the tax assessment. It was assessed in 65 at $715,000. It's never been on the market. The market is going up now that interest rates are down a little. You put together a purchase agreement that's good for 6 months. If anyone shows an interest, we'll put up the money and close the deal. Here's my opinion. The value of the place is completely in the eyes of the beholder. If some guy beholds it and wants to pay me $5 million for a property that I can get for $2.5 million, I say take it. He threw back his head and laughed at the absurdity of the idea. I said, people sell property for all kinds of reasons. But what if you have to come up with the money? Have you talked to Bart? Bart was a vice president at Portsmouth Savings and Loan, the biggest and best-financed S&L in our neighborhood. I'd had good luck with him over the years. I liked him, and he liked me. If I had well-qualified buyers, I sent them to him. But he and Gordon, though they had a good business relationship, didn't mix very well. Gordon thought Bart was too short, and Bart thought Gordon was too New York.
Not yet. I thought you could do that, just a preliminary chat. I mean, he knows us, but 20% down is $500,000. That could be something that takes a little discussion. He trusts you. And we got 6 months.
I nodded.
So, you want to stay? I guess we'll go to Manelli's for some spaghetti. Felicity and Hank are bringing the boys over.
I shook my head. Now Gordon came right up to me.
You keep Bobby out of Salt Key Farm for now. He's bound to do something to screw it up, even if it's just running his car over the outside lighting or falling down the steps. I want this deal to go smooth as possible. You do the paperwork, and I'll give you your 3%. And that means you can keep Bobby busy on something else.
I nodded. 3% of $2.5 million was $75,000. If by some piece of luck we ended up selling the place for $5 million, of course, 6% of $5 million was $300,000. That you could make that kind of money brokering real estate seemed so amazing, I didn't know what to think about it. On the way back to the office, I detoured past Salt Key Farm. The longest side of the property ran along American Legion Road. White board fencing in double rows traced the contours of the pastures, which were a thick, mature green. Fruit trees had been planted in the aisles between the fences, and carefully pruned, looked oddly Japanese, the way the dark trunks twisted within the clouds of blossom. It was late afternoon, and grooms were leading some of the horses to the barns. I didn't know too much about their horses, but some went to the racetrack, I thought. One dark figure was fixing a line of fence, hammering a board to a post, and the horses nearby were standing at attention, shining in the sunlight, their ears pricked, watching him. There was a pasture for mares and foals not far from the road, and some sort of feed had been thrown into their trough. They were lined up with their tails to the road, their heads down. For a family estate, Salt Key Farm was unusually visible from the road, but then, when the place was built, American Legion Road had been a dirt track. Where the residence had once been visible, the Thorpes had put up a high stone wall, which I soon passed, but looked at with renewed interest. It must have been 10 feet tall, faced with beautiful local sandstone the color of peaches. Against the green of the pastures, it glowed like an early sunset. Instead of continuing down American Legion Road to County 169, I turned at the farm gate onto Dixon Road and continued past the sandstone wall, which ran for maybe 200 yards, also planted with flowering trees, dogwood and redbud, which would soon be in bloom. Underneath these, a meandering track of daffodils, tulips just beginning, and iris still dormant. Outside the wall, along this little-used country road, but clearly maintained by the Thorpes, this border amounted to a private garden, dedicated to the enjoyment of very few. Not really even the Thorpes themselves, but just those who happened to make this turn, neighbors and passers-by. I had never seen it before. It was daunting to think of this property coming into Gordon's hands. Our hands. It's funny what happens. One time, Sherry and I had some friends who spent 2 years remodeling and decorating their house, which was a small brick three-bedroom in Callaway Village. Good schools, nice neighborhood, a real jewel box. When the husband was transferred to Texas suddenly, I put it on the market.
Every room was just so. Wallpaper, carpets, curtains, including the basement bathroom, which was done entirely with a Nittany Lions theme. I showed that house 100 times. Everyone said it was so cute. I got one single offer from a childless couple. The wife was blind. So much for redecorating. Very few buyers want something that is incredibly beautiful or well done. They seem to feel they are just not up to it somehow. Nevertheless, the privilege of becoming familiar with Salt Key Farm was a privilege I was glad to have, especially since I didn't have to pay for it. I couldn't imagine what Gordon would do with the place, but it was just the sort of gamble he liked. Of course, he liked every sort of gamble. Back at the office, I saw that Bobby had picked up my note and the papers. His desk was clear, except for a manila file folder labeled Burns, M. On my desk was a note from him. Call Sloan's, 856-3245, 2 p.m. It was after 5 now. I picked up the phone, but then, instead of calling, I put it back on the hook and went over to Bobby's desk and opened the cover of the Marcus Burns file. Right on top were his tax returns from 79 and 80. I picked them up and looked at them. Name, Marcus Burns. Spouse's name, Linda Burns. Gross taxable income, $125,678 and $102,345. About $30,000 each year from her. She was a teacher. They had lived in Hempstead on Long Island. He had been, as he said, employed by the IRS. He also had investment income, capital gains, and interest income. He owned his own house and deducted $10,000 mortgage interest. He used both his cars for work, depreciated them, and deducted mileage. He took a large sales tax deduction because he lived in New York and claimed 7 dependents, including himself and his wife. At the back, there was an oil depletion allowance deduction. The forms ran many pages. In 79, he had paid $15,935 in taxes, and in 80, $13,986. I picked up the mortgage application just beneath the tax forms. He was now employed as a financial advisor and investment consultant, with some work as a freelance tax specialist on the side. His estimated income for 1981 was $135,000. He was applying for a 90% loan, $25,000 down to be realized from the sale of his previous home. His payment at 12% interest would be about $2,000 per month. He was pre-qualified. The expected closing date was June 1st. I stacked the tax forms and the mortgage application together and replaced them inside the folder. He was, to all appearances, fully capable of buying Gottfried Newell's Pride and Joy and reigning income upon this office. In addition, I didn't think he needed my help. My taxable income for 1979 was more like $72,000 to pay for his fence. I went to my typewriter and tapped out another note. Tell buyer if he doesn't buy, Gottfried intends to put the house back on the market for $10,000 more, since present price doesn't cover his costs to date. Quibbling about the fence probably will kill the deal. This was actually a good idea. And if Gottfried hadn't thought of it, I would certainly suggest it if Marcus Burns made a fuss. Ah, I was in a wonderful mood. I decided to call the Sloanes in the morning. Chapter 4. By early May, I had Salt Key Farm advertised everywhere. Town and Country, the New York Times Magazine, even the Blood Horse and the Chronicle of the Horse, as a working horse-breeding establishment. Jacob Thorpe, or rather his assistant and his housekeeper and his stable manager.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.